For elections, there's already alignments being made. All right, page 10. Fake Uhuru call fraud case to start today. I don't know what you made of this call. I mean, this was one of those things that people talk about as you have coffee in the canteen. But it was interesting to see that somebody can actually be conned out of 10 million out of a phone call.
This is a bad trend that happens in this country. And these guys just, you know, utilize the opportunity that has always been there. As in when you see state officers sending their agents to collect money even from parastatals, state officers sending their, you know, their people to collect money from businessmen and promises of what, you know, tenders and, you know, all these things. So it's something that has been happening, and these guys just knew this, if we do this, we'll get money. And they took the opportunity and they did it. But they are very smart guys. Mimicking the head of state was a very bold statement. And something surprising is that the number they used, Trukola indicates that it's from the head of state. Mm. And I heard even the defense lawyer, Cliff Ombeta, saying that even if you send the M-Pesa, it will bring
the same name.
It will bring Uhuru Kenyatta as the owner of the number. So how did these people manage to register first M-Pesa using Uhuru's name where ID is required? So investigation should not even be
stop at
10 million.
There's
it should
more.
Go beyond even the service providers to find out how did these people register this number using Uhuru Kenyatta's name and, you know, making it look like
look
it's
look like it's his number.
And the lawyer was saying that he has even received such a call from the head of state. So it's upon the investigative agencies to tell us what
happened.
Really happened.
All right. And
but it's a trend that is going on, people using those opportunities to get money.
The case starts today, and of course many of us are going to be very interested to see how the investigative arms are going to unearth how this happened and what really the truth behind it is. Before we finish with the Standard, page 11, Transform Kenya. This is an initiative by the Standard Group in ensuring we talk about things that matter to you. And there was Transform Kenya yesterday. The main theme was education, and new school system takes center stage on day one of the event. And of course, one of the things that came out was the fact that 844 system has failed to prepare the learner for the 21st century survival skills.
Yeah, it might be true because we are products of 844 system. The way it started, it had some concepts of, you know, of vocational, where we did art,
agriculture,
craft, agriculture, home science, you know, such kind of trainings. Mm. But now, along the way, some subjects were scrapped, like agriculture is not taught in primary or high school, but we expect Kenya to be an agricultural country where we produce to sustain our economy. So I think there's need for restructuring the system and coming up with a system that can produce people who are ready for the market, job market. But again, I want also to question people who are in school and learners, that people don't go to school actually to be employed. Let people go to school with the open mind that at the end of the day, when you come out, you have skills, you have knowledge that can help you survive or can help you be engaged in another income-generating venture, apart from just focusing your mind on getting a job. And, you know, when you don't get, then you start crying.
You get frustrated.
You want to commit suicide. I've read stories where young people are saying they have papers, but they are not helping them, so they want to commit suicide. You know, that's the highest level of desperation that we don't expect in this country.
All right, and now we take a look at the Daily Nation, and we are back to matters probing dams and scandals. Ruto aide caught in dam scandal probe. That's the headline of the Nation. So talking about putting names to some of this money trail and paper trail, the people mentioned in the Nation, we have Ken Osinde, who's a deputy president's chief of staff, being one of those mentioned. Other players in this particular scandal, we have Salman Group Limited, Mugo Kabati, Titus Naikuni, Simeon Nyachai. and the list continues.
Those are big names, Mike, politically speaking. Those are not names that you can just wake up one day and wish them away. So, as I've said earlier, we need to see names like Osinde being put there, that Osinde is involved in the corruption. And not...
if he is involved, once the investigations have
been
done.
But these issues of associating the name with another big person, that this person is, aided to president or aided to DP. So, you know, unless the person used his powers as the DP's aide...
Or was working under instruction.
Yeah, or was working at instruction to enable him get those, to influence, access to those things. But sometimes people use their powers, the positions they have to influence, but we need to tackle this issue from where the head starts to rot.
All right. And we now look at page 4 as well. And now we're talking about that money trail and paper trail. The members of parliament had summoned the CBK governor to, question the question of, the transactions of over 1 million shillings. And CBK warns of dire consequences if new law is effected. The new law where one does not have to necessarily go through filling forms when you're transacting with over a million shillings, which is currently the case.
Yeah, I listened to the CBK governor talking about the effect of having this law passed. But again, now we have a law that prevents people from transacting over 1 million in cash, moving money from one bank to another.
Or rather explaining why you're moving the money. It doesn't stop you, but you have to explain.
But how far has it worked to prevent money laundering? How far we need to... the government need to give us statistics that these are people who have moved this money through dubious means, or they are involved in money laundering schemes and they have been prosecuted, at that end. But we still have people moving huge sums of money, and it's like normal business
as usual.
Yeah. Then you look at what he was talking about, that 99% of Kenyans, actually 99.3%
of accounts,
have less than a million in their accounts, or deposit less than a million. Then you wonder how effective is this law in trying to curb what it was supposed to do. Because if people are not transacting in millions, then it means people are keeping cash in their
at home. And there is evidence that there are some people who've been caught with millions in their houses.
So this law could be helping, but at the same time punitive, and it prevents people from banking. So we leave so many people unbanked, and it also creates a security threat.
Absolutely. And that story continues, and we'll wait and see what Parliament is going to decide finally. But the CBK is warning that Kenya would be in a lot of trouble in terms of banking laws nationwide, or rather worldwide. On page 5, Jumwa Dory to know their fate when ODM top brass meet on Friday. So they're still waiting, but one might say that the die is already cast.
Yeah, the die is already cast, and it actually sends... bad signal on the part of ODM, because this is a party that initiated handshake with the Jubilee. And from Doris and Jumwa's story, is like the handshake was only between two people, but not actually the followers or their supporters or their party members, So it saddens those people who are involved in this art of politics that you have your party leaders preaching, preaching wine, but followers are not supposed
to drinking wine. Yes, they're not supposed to drink the same.
To drink wine, it's like we are here, but you maintain your lens. Don't interact with these and these people. So, as much as we talk about building bridges, the issue of Jumwa and Dory is actually widening and breaking the bridges that we are told are being built. So I think it would have been prudent for ODM, because they have apologized, for the ODM to pardon them and tell that things can happen and we are in the building bridges era, so people can interact across parties and make sure that we move forward as a country.
All right, and we'll wait and see. Friday it is, and we'll wait to hear, although from ODM, and I think from the Secretary General, he had said that it has already been decided
yeah.
by NEC that they are going to be ejected from the party. They tried to appeal that, but let's wait and hear, because Friday is D-Day for them. Page 8 and 9 highlights what we're going to be talking about later on right here in the newsroom. And page 8 has long wait for suspects in Wamboi murder case. Remember, this is a case that has been ongoing of one Corey and Wamboi, Wangoi. And Wangoi is the lady, Wamboi is the lady who's been murdered and killed, but it highlights domestic violence. Also on page 9, we have Beryl was strangled, doctors rule. Beryl is a lady who was killed by the husband, or is alleged was killed by the husband, and there had been issues that had been highlighted of domestic violence previously. I don't know your thoughts on domestic violence, and maybe whether as a society, as a community, we have been able to talk about it so that we can deal with it.
Mike, there are increasing rates of domestic violence, and these violence are now becoming fatal. We see people dying, people committing suicide, people, you know, killing each other. And it has been, traditionally, women have been seen not to be talking about violence in their houses. Mm. They have normalized these issues. But it's high time that women start pointing out against violent husbands, violent partners. You know, it starts from the relationships. When you are dating somebody and every time is shouting at you, every time is, raising a hand at you, her fingers at you, those are warning signs.
Mm.
So when the moment you tie the knot and you start fighting in the house, and it becomes something that it looks normal. Even when neighbors ask you, hey, yesterday we had some scuffles in your houses. No, it's just normal. It was
we shy to talk about
our own issues. We shall sort out our own issues. No, people should learn to talk about these issues. They should learn to speak out, because it's leading to so much. People are losing, daughters. People are losing their mothers, through these things.
Mm.
So domestic violence actually should be treated as crime. And to avert that, people should be strong enough, especially women, should be bold enough, the same way they expose men who are stingy and say, oh, my boyfriend does not give me this and this. They should also come out and speak out about violent boyfriends or husbands.
And maybe just to highlight that it's not actually just women that suffer violence, but also men as well. And there is the issue of whether men are able to come out and say that they're actually being
about,
abused domestically.
It's about society, Mike. Mm. And as men grow up, when you cry, your mother tells you, men don't cry, men don't talk about this, So as we grow up, we are socialized. Men are socialized to withstand or to swallow so much. But it comes a time that they need also to come out
and speak out.
If your spouse is violating you, is abusing you, there was an organization called Maendeleo Wanaume. I don't know what happened to it. I think we need such kind of initiative.
It is still around, and we were going to have the chair, Mr. Njoka, but he's not available. But anyway, we need to take a break right now. So thank you very much.